Computer-generated imagery, or CGI for short, is a term that describes digitally created images in film and television. CGI is a subcategory of visual effects, VFX, imagery filmmakers create or manipulate that does not exist in the physical environment being captured on film or video.
CGI is a subcategory of visual effects, VFX, imagery filmmakers create or manipulate that does exist in a physical environment being captured on film or video. CGI is one of the most used tools commonly in cinema, just about every movie now shown in theatres using some form of computer-generated imagery. Even films you wouldn't expect to use CGI, like the recent King Richard, enlisted it in it to create a believable tennis sequence. It is a creation that has been fully, and some would say overly, embraced by filmmakers, to varying levels of success. But whatever your opinion at this point, it seems near impossible to imagine films being made without extensive CGI use. However, throughout the first 80 years of its creation, CGI was not used at all, with all effects needed to be created practically or by hand manipulating film. Miniatures, mirrors, puppets, a lot of puppets.
505-345-675 Delta 9. 505-345-675.
And then came the 1973 sci-fi western, Westworld. The film has seemingly been forgotten other than a relatively successful HBO show, but when it came out, its computer-generated imagery was revolutionary. This is it. By today's standards, it's nothing special. I wanted to recreate it, I could just do this. It's not very hard, it just doesn't look great. But the reason it's easy for me is because I'm using a computer, everything I'm working with is digital. In 1973, nothing film related was really digital. Movies were filmed on film, chemical, grainy process. So, to create an effect that would encapsulate the entire screen, director Michael Crichton would have to think outside the box. As mentioned, this was the first time CGI had been used in a movie, however, there had been some previous experimentation using digital images. Zorbas had to create a title sequence for the 1954 film Vertigo, full of overlapping integrate circles, and had used a repurposed mechanical computer from an M5 anti-aircraft gun to draw the integrate patterns. After that similar experiment with computers drawing elaborate designs were attempted, none made it into major motion movies, with shorts like John Whitley Sr.'s Permutations being relegated to somewhat unknown short art films.
It's true that after the 40s and the period of those films, I felt that either there was have to be some way of making revolutionary new ways of doing abstract design in front of a camera, or possibly there was some missing element, some sort of a machine. I began to think in terms of a design machine.
Crichton did, however, find his inspiration for how to achieve the effect elsewhere. He found it from space. More seriously, what was floating above him in space. On November 28, 1964, at 9:22 a.m. in Cape Canaveral, Florida, NASA launched the spacecraft Mariner 4.
Mm-hmm.
Mariner 4 was, quote, the fourth in a series of spacecraft intended for planetary exploration by flyby mode. It was designed to conduct close-up scientific observations of Mars and to transmit these observations to Earth. Mariner 4 took 22 pictures of Mars on July 14th and 15th in 1965, the first pictures of Mars ever taken, important to NASA and remembered because it was what gave us knowledge that Mars had a surface densely covered in craters. But these pictures were also important in how they were sent 166 million miles back to Earth. Instead of sending the full image, they were sent back as a code of numbers. Each number was a code for a specific shade, which a computer would then color by a specific square. More or less, the first close-up pictures of Mars were a paint by numbers. The shots were supposed to display the viewpoint of the movie's titular robot villain, which the writers and computer program Alexander Galloway would later describe as computerized cybernetic mechanic vision. Director Michael Crichton, inspired to make the movie after seeing astronauts interacting with robots to train for space missions, struggled to create what a robot would see. The only film to do something similar was 2001: A Space Odyssey, which had just been shown with a wide-angle lens. With the films also depicting computerized cybernetic mechanic vision like Robocop, Predator, or the Terminator franchise, long yet to come out. Crichton's script, when describing the gunslinger's vision, saying, bizarre computerized vision of the world, with flashed up calculated figures and shifting green tones which apparently represented shifts in the gunslinger's concentration. To create the effect, Crichton decided to approach John Whitley Sr. Remember him? Whitley, then busy, passed on to his son John Whitley Jr., who in naivety assured Crichton he'd be able to create the shots whilst meeting the movie's budget and time schedule, agreeing to create the effect in 4 months for $20,000. Inspired by the aforementioned pictures, Whitley decided on an effect that would create a mosaic of small squares, but he was still a ways off from there being a significant difference between taking pictures and video. So he spent the next few months working on with scientists to develop a technique where the computer could scan film and add the effect and then convert it back to celluloid footage. The process that was used is a little confusing, so if you're not interested, just skip ahead. As mentioned, the effect Whitley realized he had to create was by scanning film into a computer that would look at the area in brightness to create pixels before physically exposing the stock onto new film with a new pixelated view. To create the effect, they used the FR-80 from AAA, which is often called the III from Information International. The FR-80 had a computer that was a copy of the DEC PDP-15, which is a range of computers released in 1970 that could convert images into 18-bit pictures. It had been made before today's 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, and 40-bit pictures, with a universal size not yet being agreed upon. The FR-80 had the ability to scan and export new film just as Whitley desired, however the film still required work. To output the film stock, the image had to be displayed on a cathode array, as well as arrangement of lenses exposed to film. To recognize what it was seeing, actors would have to wear brightly contrasting clothing to the background. The film was then color separated into four different black and white films, each for a different color, one black, one red, one green, and one blue, with each shot of the images processed separately before they could be put back together. The computer's assembly language involved, shown in the film, code seeming to read the PDP/III-15 on the FR-80 computer. The work totaling in 2 minutes and 30 seconds of actual footage, fixing all the processor's bugs alone taking around 2 months. Each frame had about 3,600 pixels, with it taking about 10 seconds to scan each frame, or 8 hours for just 10 seconds of footage. The process went over budget and time, with nearly pushing the movie back months, with MGM relying on the movie for the studio. Producer Paul N. Nazareth III saying, "We went through screening after screening with the people at Metro, MGM, with scene missing cards. We came within 2 weeks of having to cancel the release date." frequently saying in retrospective, once the computer had read the images and converted into a series of numbers, there's tremendous flexibility in what the computer can do with this numerical information. The image can be reconstituted with different contrasts, different resolutions, different colors. We can enlarge, we can stretch, squeeze, twist, rotate in any space in any way. The fact that the only limitation we imposed upon ourselves was the creative talents of the person operating the machine. The film industry did take its time to catch up with Whitley's vision, his later work continuing to nudge Hollywood towards the digital imaging. The movie's cheesy sequel Future World, taking effects further, creating a 3D representation of Henry Fonda's head, as well as a 3D animated hand created by Ed Catmull, future co-founder of Pixar. Star Wars would use CGI animation, computers, and tracking pads, as well as display screens. Crichton would use 3D scans in his later movie Looker. James Cameron would use liquid simulations in The Abyss and morph simulations in Terminator Judgment Day. Spielberg would create dinosaurs in Jurassic Park, and it really just took off from there. Whitley wrote in an article for American Cinematographer, "My work on Westworld suggested many possibilities. We were able to explore, and there was certainly more yet to be imagined."
It's difficult, but the point is that this beginning to search for some sort of a machine, a design machine, came to fruition when, with, from my point of view, with the development of the graphic display capability of the computer. Mm-hmm. And I have, to put it in very simple terms, I look upon the computer as capable of producing, capable of manipulating a visual experience in almost exactly the same way that the whole family of musical instruments manipulate oral experience.
Hi, this is Luke. If you like that video, please like and subscribe, and click the bell icon for notifications about new videos.